Hello my guys, gals and non-binary pals to another video from Them Fatales. I'm Alicia and this is going to be probably a video similar to what you've seen Raven do after I did the fatphobia and racism video, where basically she talked about her own experience sort of buying into fatphobia, let's say, and basically what her redemption arc was. Hopefully that's in a similar air to what I'm gonna do here. I need to make a disclaimer though. This video was very hard to prepare and brought me back to places that I really don't like, because I wasn't a person that I am proud of. So keeping that in mind, this is mine and Raven's personal experience. It doesn't have to be applying to anyone, but I hope the hope that drives me in this is that if I share where I've been and how I've come out of it, you don't necessarily have to go through the same steps, but maybe it's going to be useful to someone who was as lost and potentially going into bad directions as I was at some point. Without any further ado, let's talk about how TERFs almost recruited me. You look like you came out of the pages of one of my mangas. That's the first thing that I said to Raven, and Raven was indeed the most elegant and delicate and graceful feminine boy I had ever had the luck to lay my eyes upon. I've always had a thing for very feminine guys, like tall, lanky. I grew up on mangas and that stuck with me to a level deeper than awareness. They were all the most romantic characters if they melted into flesh. This is the face of beauty to me, I told them the very first night that we met. On our second date, most of the night was spent putting them in my clothes and taking pictures that the next day read, "When your boyfriend looks better than you in your own clothes." A part of me, in hindsight, wonders if the reason why such a wonderful creature would fall for me was the inadvertent boost of gender euphoria I gave them by proposing that we shoot pictures of them in my outfits that second night. When we first slept together, we both were wearing fishnets. A very apparent reason for my attraction to Raven, which then quickly became love, was how feminine of a boy I thought they were. They have always appeared so self-sufficient and cool, but being comfortable in girls' clothing was taking that to 11 to me. Our first club night, I suggested they wear one of my lace dresses because it just looked so effortlessly beautiful on her. And she was spinning light, and there is not an image more ethereal than that in my mind. We would go to parties and, of course, to the pride parades, both in full femme presentation. And I loved them for it. They just looked so insanely cool and delicate at the same time. So really, when I think about it, it does seem out of character for me to have almost been recruited by TERFs in the months following Raven's coming out to me as a trans woman. I have basically been raised by drag queens. As soon as I started working, I finally found my kind of people, as finally I was exposed to real-life queer people who, in the noughties, populated the entertainment industry. The general idea that everyone was a bit gay and it's fine, that, I kid you not, was given off by the UK to me before I moved, was probably behind my many reasons to want to move to London. And I always took identity at face value. You tell me you're gay, you tell me you're a woman or a man, that's what you are to me. The cis or trans prefix didn't mean much to me. You just were who you were. And while I've absolutely adored being around my gay friends, I was scared shitless of women. For the petty jealousy and the competition, partially. being the kid who would always be cornered and beaten up by other girls might have affected it, but truly, I had to live with my mother abusing my body for 12 years. In hindsight, ironically, drag queens were such an escapism and motherly figure to me because in my history, men wearing a dress were much less dangerous than the woman who had legal access to my body and took full advantage of it. You can say I had some unresolved baggage around womanhood because of that. Not only in being told not to be like other girls, to imply that you needed to live to be better than your gender mates, but also watching your back from them, hey, from any same-sex interaction that could precipitate in sexual. It's not nice when all you have associated with women and sex is your own mother touching your body inappropriately. So, of course, I panicked the fuck out. When Raven first told me that she was trans, the first thing I said after that was, well, what a lovely couple of lesbians will be. I was nothing but supportive. I held her so closely and thanked her for telling me. I was excited for her having finally found herself. But then she started talking about transitioning, about the steps that would be taken, about the things that would change. And that's when the realization of what this all meant suddenly hit me. Raven didn't change suddenly the moment that she told me she was a woman. She was literally the same person. But I think the way that we have been educated to think of gender as a foundation of people, that immediately made me feel that she wanted to become a completely different person from the one that I knew. And I tied myself to for eternity. And two things really made this ignorant projection snowball to the infamous elaboration of that apparently most people, family and partners of queer people, seem to go through when someone they know comes out. And I grieved for my Robin. First issue, the issue of womanhood. The womanhood we are raised and think it's normal, and yet it's the patriarchal idea of womanhood to keep us against each other. The idea that girls have an innate sense of pettiness and competition. They are vain and their value is warranted if they stand out and are special. Not like the other girls. As to say that their gender is inherently bad. But if you manage not to embody those pesky standard traits of femininity, you're the good one. Like a manic pixie dream girl would say, you're one of a kind. Gotta give it to patriarchy. They try to keep us distracted fighting ourselves with a crab in a bucket mentality, much like capitalism tries to make the middle class think the immigrants want their cookie, not the billionaire who already has literally a billion. Issue number two were that the only examples from reality of transitions, which are at best people who, apart from transitioning, have not necessarily anything in common with our situation and relationship. And at worst, by the popularized stories, especially of trans women becoming all of a sudden selfish and vain and narcissistic, which I discovered later are actually fantastic stories put out by TERFs. I remember one specifically on Reddit once, and without first-hand knowledge of a trans person, someone from the outside just might take it as true. It wasn't in that case, it was very obviously a TERF trolling, but it got spread like wildfire before it was found out, and partially indeed affected the way that I saw and behaved towards what was told to me was a trans woman. The places I tried to learn from, which were supposed to be safe, like the subreddit mypartneristrans, turned out not to be at all. Every doubt I had, especially in those first formative months, was met with, you should just break up. which seems kind of to defeat the point of a place called My Partner is Trans. Then I found a comment by a moderator of the place openly saying that their standard approach to any couple where a person has come out as trans is to convince them to break up, which makes me question to this day how effective it must have been, since for months it brought me to feel so inadequate as a partner that I got close to break up with Raven myself. And by the way, that place is easy hunting territory for no other than gender-critical people, aka TERFs. That's where I was headhunted, and ironically what made me realize no thanks was that in trying to use my confusion and doubts to their advantage, they showed that cattiness and pettiness that I feared would just suddenly appear in Raven the moment she started transitioning. Guess what? She was never that, and she never will be. I admittedly spent months trying to make my ideas of gender and sexuality reconcile. The one thing everyone says is you can't change your sexuality, even though there are plenty of examples of same-sex couple where one or both identify as straight. But what was never considered by any person I was hoping to get help from was the foundation. This stupid, insane love that I have for Raven. From day one, they were perfect to me. They were the representation, body and mind, of every better dream I had about, well, a prince charming in the mind of someone raised as hetero being the only option. I can say now truly, all of my fear and rejection came from ignorance. And at the beginning, with misinformation spread like wildfire, I thought that transitioning meant that both the body and the mind of the person were to change. They wanted them to change. And my thoughts were basically, you can't improve on perfection. Worse, why would you take my perfect Robin from me when you promised, when he promised to be with me forever? I genuinely started to see Raven not only as the reason why I was losing my husband, but as the literal woman who was taking him from me. Because say what you want, but in the patriarchal idea of womanhood, what's more feminine than jealousy and pettiness, am I right? I started to develop for her the same feelings I had for people my ex cheated with. Our life as I knew it was crumbling, and I was absolutely certain that that was the reality of things. I was advised to either demand compromise to see how important I was, or the absolute opposite, that nothing was more important than their gender or my sexual identity, and we should just break up and go find what we wanted in other people. And that's when it started to hit me. In all the advice given to partners, this thing about personal identity was considered separate and higher than the life they had shared and built with this person. Fundamentally, the idea perpetrated around was that if I am heterosexual and my husband had come out as my wife, the person they were and I thought they were didn't matter, didn't exist, never probably existed, and my sexuality was therefore what to listen to. Go out and find yourself a man, because that's what your sexual identity demands. Same way the other way around, by the way. You come out as a woman, but your wife is not a lesbian. How dare you not respect their sexuality with your existence? You need to leave her first and then transition. The bottom line was indeed, as the mod admitted, to just break these couples. And I can understand, in a way, why. In the few spaces there are, and with the relentless attacks from uneducated people devoted to the status quo, a generic protection of identity as a concept beyond the case at hand is just the safe thing to prioritize in a world that is just about creating statistics. That became hunting territory for TERFs, though, goes to show that humans mattered more than statistics. Now, I have a bit of an extreme romantic ideal. It's not for everyone, but it's total and encompasses everything. And that's where the idea of you can't change your identity, go find yourself a man, started to sound really stupid to me. I have dated men. They have been a problematic bunch at best in my history. In hindsight, I don't think it's by chance that the one man I ended up falling so incredibly head over feet that I ended up marrying them was actually not a man. Oh, and I wasn't the marrying kind at all. I wonder to this day, knowing how against marriage I was, how Raven brave to propose, but oh, am I glad that she did. So again, this idea that this perfect person was to be killed by this supposed new woman started to not hold water. This woman was actually where the mind and the body I knew was still. Why would I leave that perfection for the anonymous idea of a man was what my sexual identity required? And to be honest about sexual identity, before Raven, I reasonably thought myself asexual. TMI coming. She's the only person who cared enough to ever make me come. So really, even calling myself demisexual, truth is, I had never enjoyed sex that wasn't with Raven. It was a duty with every other person I slept with. I wasn't going to blindly believe a blank person would have made me happier than Raven. Just because they were a man? That's absurd to me. This person right here is the perfect person for me. They have every day that we've been together made me happy, cared for me, and loved me the way I understand love. And they have been outstandingly responsive to the details of my identity that no one ever got. How could I think something as abstract as gender or sexual identity could matter more than being with this person that makes me happy, and that before this turmoil, I used to make happy too? The answer to me was that, call me what you wish, try to break us, make me want to burn bras or enjoy fishnets, I just want Raven. Would I have been with a girl before her? Probably not. But I wouldn't want to be with a man after either. I don't want another person, I just want her. I'm Raven sexual and Raven romantic, and for how I lived this relationship, this was truly the easiest way to navigate things for me. Once I got hold of this truth, regardless of how every space that should have helped me gave me this strict idea of gender and sexuality that had to exist beyond your partner, those are abstracts. And to project images on those abstracts, I made our lives a roller coaster of emotions for almost an entire year after Raven came out. In hindsight, she wasn't changing. I was. I was falling short of my love and promises for her. And all of that was based on the idea that gender has to be the foundation of a person. And if that perception changed, than the person did. I'll tell you what did change. After 2 years of presenting femininely and living as herself, with me anyway, since taking HRT, I've seen her express actual joy. One of the sticking points between us when I did end up demanding a compromise, wanting to know that I was more important than something like HRT, Raven couldn't understand why I wanted her to spend her life being unhappy. And all I heard was that that meant she wasn't happy with me. She tried to reassure me that her life with me was better than it ever was or ever could be. But then no, she did not experience happiness. She never had and didn't think she ever could. after seeing the instant change in suddenly her being able to feel happiness, turns out that there is a neurological link between having the wrong hormones and how the brain deals with serotonin and therefore happiness. She was physically unable to feel that emotion, and now she can. And it gives me so much joy to see her like that. But truly, there was one event that really made everything fall into place. And as most situations that requires empathy, I had to actually grow sympathy. Because empathy is the ability to just understand someone else's feeling. Sympathy is when those feelings are shared. Now, this is my experience, so if you find it reductive or offensive, I apologize. This is the way I understood dysphoria and works for me to understand Raven. So far, every time there would be something I don't understand that would make me irrationally feel attacked by something that Raven does to further the manifestation of her gender identity, I reported to my experience in my fat body. A body that I don't recognize as giving the information about me on first look, as the business card that a body is in the world. Almost a year after Raven came out, I started having health issues with my body. No matter what I did, it would not respond to my actions the way normal bodies are supposed to. After months, I finally caved and accepted to see a private doctor. The idea and hope that that action could finally bring congruence between my actions and my body was literally the one thing I would wake up for in the morning. The idea that something could be done to finally, eventually wake up and see in the mirror what I am meant to see. And that's when it clicked. That day, I told Raven anything, absolutely anything she needed to do to feel like she was in control of her body, she had to do. I would have been behind her 110%. Forbidding her anything would have been the equivalent of her forbidding me to take action to try and have my body reflect the person I feel I am, just because she can love me in the body that I have now anyway. I don't love me in the body I have now. She does. But it's deeper than existing to be loved, even by the object of your absolute adoration. There is a picture in my mind of the person who deserves that love and who could accept it and believe it right to be at the receiving end of that love. And it's not the body that I have today. And in fairness, I think we should have a conversation about how self-acceptance needs not to overtake our rights to become who we want to be. And in the fat world, the one I belong to, too often it's sold as the only option. If you love yourself and you don't want to just be a victim of society, forgetting that we are still in a world that no matter the self-acceptance will use my body against me to abuse me. Isn't that similar, even though probably barely 100, to wanting to present like your gender enough not to be abused by people who think you should be something else? If you think about it, it's an extension of beauty standards to gender standards. And just like we discussed in the fatphobia and racism video, no one ends up a better person with a reductive idea of what a beautiful girl, or even just a girl, a person, is. How we look presents us as the person we are to others, even before we get to actually speak. But all those signifiers that semiotic loves so much to tell us about, some we can modify. Our style, our clothing, hair, makeup, our proxemics to a degree. The way that we hold a glass, fundamentally, when we're about to drink, stuff like that. But others are just completely precluded, no matter what we say, no matter what we wear. I've never been seen as delicate, as graceful, because no. Fat is the elephant in the china shop. It's goofy, and bulky and comedic at best. But I think of myself as that, or I think that's a quality I should have that would speak of me more authentically than I feel the implication of my fat body does. I'm not lazy, I'm not smelly, I'm not disgusting, well, unless I want to, but I'm not as a default, and yet I'm always seen as such because of the unconscious bias of prejudice about who we are for how we present, whether that's for good or bad. Yes, it would be ideal to live in a society where no one did, but we do. And in some sort of self-fulfilling prophecy, treating people on their aesthetic signifiers reinforces that behavior. Whether with fascination, if it fits with our idea of good, or with disgust, if it fits the opposite, without having ever even interacted with this person. So at the very least, we need to be afforded the fundamental right, not the privilege, the right to work and use those signifiers that hold us back from who we are, the way that we prefer and adhere to our own image of ourselves. All the rest will still be playing against us. It's the bare minimum to work on it, to be who we are, just trapped in a body that, because of societal expectation, have us treated in ways that make us feel degraded and unreal otherwise. Was this useful? I don't know if this was useful, but it's basically what happened in my life from sort of a complete ignorance and a certain attitude that I thought I had based on the outside world that then put me in the position rightfully to check with my hypocrisy, if there was any, because everybody is good to be an ally if they don't have to have first-hand experience of a situation. This was how I handled it, not at my best. But I got through it, and hopefully I try every day to make up for the stuff that I didn't live up to before. I'm gonna close this here. I think there's gonna be another one video before the new video essay, which is gonna come out on the first Monday of September. I think what we're gonna do now is gonna have the first Monday of every month for the new essay, and then we'll have general commentary videos on the other Mondays. If you like what we do and would like to support our work, you can send us a PayPal donation, which is a one-off. If you think that it's really valuable somehow, there's Patreon. You can subscribe and then do a monthly payment there. If you want to reach us, Patreon is also a good idea. And thank you for having the patience to go through this with me. I will see you soon.